Horrorcore, also known as horror hip-hop or death rap. It's a subgenre of hip-hop music based on horror-themed and often darkly transgressive lyrical content. Horrorcore artists often push the violent content and imagery in their lyrics beyond the realm of realism. Violent, ghoulish, unsettling, slasher type. While the exaggerated violence and the supernatural are common in horrorcore genre, it also presents frequently more realistic yet disturbing portrayals of mental illness and drug abuse. In 1995, Entertainment Weekly attempted to describe the new genre, calling it a blend of hardcore rap and bloodthirsty metal. The lyrical content of horrorcore is sometimes described similar of that of death metal. Horrorcore has incited controversy with some members of the law enforcement community. They asserted that the genre has incited crimes. Fans and artists have been blamed for numerous high-profile crimes, including Columbine, the Red Lake High School massacre, the Farmville murders, and multiple attacks on law enforcement.
Lyrics about murder and rape, fans with gory costumes. Tonight, we take you inside horrorcore. Good evening, I'm Ken Bastida. This is a style of hardcore rap that takes horror to a whole new level. But some fans seem to take the music message a little too far. Joe Vasquez tonight with a closer look at the music linked to a string of recent murders.
It's hard to say what the first ever horrorcore song was, but some like to argue that Jimmy Spicer's 1980 Adventures of Super Rhyme was perhaps the first example of anything that resembled horrorcore, due to the segment of the song in which he recounts his experience meeting Dracula. 1988, DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince released A Nightmare on My Street, which described an encounter with Freddy Krueger. The same year, the Fat Boys recorded Are You Ready for Freddy for the film A Nightmare on Elm Street 4. Gangsta Nip is a rapper from South Park, Houston, Texas. A member of the South Park Coalition, which he co-founded in 1987 with fellow Houston rapper K. Rhino. The NIP in his name stands for Nation of Islam is Powerful, which he is part of. He's part of the Nation of Islam. He's looked at as one of the creators of horrorcore. In 1992, he would release his debut album, South Park Psycho. This record also helped put South Park Coalition's name on the map due to its worldwide distribution from Rap-A-Lot Records. He also wrote one of the biggest horrorcore songs of all time, Ghetto Boys' hit Chucky.
The inventor of horrorcore is none other than Gangsta Nip. You know, Psycho Nip, Brother Nip, whatever name you want to refer to him as, Nip is the originator of the horrorcore style. And
the first documented time fans would hear the word horrorcore was in 1991 on KMC's Three Men with the Power of 10 album. It was by rapper Kool Keith who has claimed to invent the word. Kool Keith has brought significant attention to the horrorcore genre, and he's done a lot to promote the art. Often credited as being one of the major pioneer and even main creators of horrorcore, Brother Lynch Hung himself claims that his style is literally less horrorcore and instead falls more directly under his own distinct category or subcategory of rap called Ripgut, which specifically emphasizes usually graphic violence. The Ripgut genre itself reportedly stemmed from his love of meat. This lyrical style is sometimes considered to be associated or connected with common thoughts or feelings experienced during manic or violent states of mind, brought on by certain illicit drugs.
Did you create horrorcore, or was it done before?
Well,
and if so, by who?
I don't think I'm horrorcore. I think I'm ripped up, which nobody else is. You know what I mean?
That's you.
I'm ripped up. I rap about meat, and like human meat and stuff like that. Horrorcore is like boof. You know what I mean? I'm not that kind of. Mine is like human meat. Mine is cannibalism type.
I don't know.
It could be in that category because there's probably nowhere else.
Brother Lynch Hung would go on to have a pretty dope career. When he first hit the rap scene, he came on strong with two friends. The first was fellow MC X-Rated. X-Rated's first album, Psychoactive, was recorded back in 1990. It wouldn't get released until 1992. X-Rated claims that the recordings were made deadly during a conflict. It was between the 24th Street Garden Block Crips and the Meadowview Bloods. March 1992, X-Rated would be arrested, along with four other gang members, for murdering Patricia Harris in her home. He was convicted of first-degree murder with special circumstances of gang-related homicide and was sentenced to 31 years to life in prison. X-Rated has since been released and is signed with Strange Music.
About a gang murder, a grieving family, and a California law barring prisoners from profiting off their crime. As Cheryl Hurd reports, those elements are at the center of a struggle which pits the rights of crime victims against that of prisoners.
Patty Harris died at the hands of a group of gang members. They knocked down her door and shot her to death. 18-year-old Honore Brown was arrested and eventually convicted of the murder. He's been serving out his 31-year sentence, as well as carrying out his career as a rap artist. His most recent album is called Vengeance Is Mine and was released while Brown was behind bars here at Mule Creek State Prison in Amador County. X-Rated's latest album was released November 21st. He spent that day in segregated housing while officers searched his cell for recording devices.
We don't believe that those vocal tracks were done within the confines of our prison.
Did you record Vengeance Is Mine in this prison?
No.
How'd you do it?
It was recorded at Salinas Valley State Prison. I had an opportunity to do songs. Then I had hundreds memorized and written down, and when I got the opportunity, I recorded every song that I had in my mind.
The opportunity he's speaking of came when a corrections officer smuggled recording equipment into Salinas Valley State Prison. The California Department of Corrections investigated the case. The officer was fired, and Brown was transferred to Mule Creek. From the state's perspective, the damage was done. The music was already out there.
Basically, I have a catalog deep enough to drop another 10 albums if I chose to.
Jackson. He may not have that choice. California's Son of Sam law prohibits prisoners from profiting off their crime. Attorney General Bill Lockyer has filed a Son of Sam suit against Brown, but both Brown and his producer at Black Market Records in Sacramento say this law doesn't apply because he's not rapping about the crime he's in for. Patty Harris's family says there are similarities between these lyrics and the murder.
If his name is Triple Six Bounty, well, it was, you know what I mean? So, like, imagine anything under that umbrella. His raps, he loves to just go overboard, more overboard than I do. That's where I learned it from. That's what his raps was about. I don't think he did it, but his raps would make you think that he did it.
Got convicted and went to prison for, I guess, raping his kids?
That's what they say.
You know what? Him and his wife.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know what? Before, the day before that happened, he had this big party, and we were, at the time, not around each other because we had fell out. And one day I got this call. He said, we're getting together, having this party. And I said, well, yeah, I'll come by. Went by there, partied, got drunk, said our goodbyes. Next thing you know, I never saw him again. Next thing I know, I seen his face on the news about that.
He was convicted on like 15 counts of child molestation and everything. Like,
yeah,
it's really fucked up.
Yeah, and yeah, he's a horny dude.
Acid rap, it's the venom, it's the spit, it's modern day blues. It's the venom that, once it gets inside of you, it takes over your bloodstream. It's potent. There's an old legend that when people get invoked by the spirit, they, you know, if they're very spiritual, they'll start running around and speaking languages and things that they know nothing about. So the tongues is basically about that.
Esham is a Detroit legend. And when it comes to this genre, he's idolized by his peers. His debut release, Boomin' Words from Hell, came out in 1989. His music style has been described as a fusion of hip-hop beats and death metal lyrics. He found it difficult to develop a fan base because many wrote off his dark content and lyrics as shock value content. The Ghetto Boys earned notoriety for their lyrics covering controversial topics such as violence, sex, and of course drugs. Each member is known to spit murderous raps. I'd have to say, I consider Bushwick Bill the most horrorcore member in the group.
It's all about teamwork. There's enough to feed all on God's green earth. I reverse the game, now I be first. Niggas try to act killer, but I seen worse. Flee first or get a taste of our dessert. Eagle, wet t-shirts, I hurt people.
Bushwick Bill was born in Kingston, Jamaica, and he was born with dwarfism, being listed at just a 3'8" height. And on June 19, 1991, Bushwick Bill shot himself during an argument with his girlfriend, losing his right eye in the process. He had been under the influence of Everclear and PCP. The aftermath of the incident was documented on the cover of the Ghetto Boys' 1991 album We Can't Be Stopped, which shows Bill being pushed through the hospital by bandmates Willie D and Scarface. Bill claimed to have died and come back to life in the incident, and he makes references to this in his music. Unfortunately, on June 9th, 2019, we lost Bushwick for real, and it was due to cancer. Cosmic Slop Shop was an American hip-hop group from Oakland, California. The group was composed of Big Lurch, Dooney Baby, and Rick Rock. Their single Sinful, from their only studio debut album Da Family, was a minor hit back in 1998. It reached number 66 on the hip-hop charts. Rick Rock and Dooney Baby would go on to form another group called The Federation. Big Lurch, however, he would go down a different path.
But a mother named Carolyn thinks about what happened to her daughter.
And I feel everyone should know what happened to her because it was a brutal murder. He chewed a part of her intestines.
21-year-old Tynesha Sias never thought about the danger. She and her boyfriend were rooming with aspiring musician Antron Singleton. The 6'6" rapper, nicknamed Big Lurch, not only smoked PCP, he sings odes to its power. A power that finally overwhelmed him. Tynesha paid the price. Singleton used this 3-inch paring knife and cut her open.
I don't think in his 26 years he's ever indicated a propensity to eat people or do the things that he did to this young lady.
Attorney Milton Grimes is representing Singleton in his upcoming trial.
This young man is walking down the street 2:00 in the afternoon, butt naked, and blood is all over his face, and blood is on his arms and his hands and his chest.
Police arrested the raving rapper and placed him in LA County psych ward. In an exclusive interview, Singleton talked to us from jail.
Do you know that you were actually chewing on her flesh, allegedly, when the cops came?
No, I didn't know nothing about that. The next thing I remember is waking up in a room by myself, and it was horrible. I mean, and I'm thinking, what am I doing here?
Do you remember getting angry at the victim or at her boyfriend?
I mean, all I can remember, you know, the world was gonna end. And I had to find the devil and kill the devil before the world ended. That's the last thought that I had.
This drug is not a plaything. It's not a beer. It's not a marijuana cigarette. This is something so mind-altering that it will make you a cannibal or a beast.
Gruesome lyrics that sing the praises of murder, suicide, and rape. It is called horrorcore rap, and the controversy over the music is only making it more mainstream.
Fox 8's Mark Zinni taking you behind the lyrics for a closer look at the message.
Like a scary movie. Horrorcore music is intense and gruesome, and almost all off-limits for television. Dating back to the early 90s, horrorcore takes gangster rap and death metal to new levels by glamorizing some of the worst acts of violence.
Our music deals with stuff like murder, suicide, you know, occult stuff,
you know what I mean? Rape and anything that's crazy that's gonna offend you a little bit.
Mars considers himself one of the hottest horrorcore artists right now, touring with the likes of Insane Clown Posse. They get the credit for taking horrorcore mainstream. Music that reaches out to a certain fan base that wants releases like Schoolhouse Glock. The album cover art pretty much says it all for fans looking for violence in music.
It's just fantasy, it has its purpose, and it's to entertain.
Investigators say at least two people have taken the music seriously. In 2005, a high school student who police say was a regular on Mars's website killed 9 people in Minnesota. In September, 4 people were killed in Virginia, and the accused killer, a 20-year-old horrorcore fan known as Psycho Sam, who used to go to Mars' shows.
They say horrorcore is considered underground, but artists, of course, like Insane Clown Posse, have releases that have gone platinum, selling more than 1 million albums.
The Duke of the Wicked. This home does not look like an Insane Clown Posse lair. It looks more like the kind of place you'd visit on the weekend for apple cider and donuts, a place where your grandmother would live.
You know, I've been in a lot of predator houses in my day, but this is something different. Immediately, I'm overwhelmed by the stench of both cat urine and motor oil. I can see looking around, though, that there is enough room to jam 50 or so juggalos in here for a live concert event. Fortunately, it's going to be an acoustic show because, based upon this raggedy asshole carpeting, I don't think it could take any more Figo being sprayed on it.
A genre often appealing to teens is called horrorcore, and there is no bigger name than the Insane Clown Posse. But while this pair may just rap about acts of savagery and violence, some of their devoted fans are living them. Hence the question, should these artists share in the blame? I asked them. February 2009. Two men calling themselves Juggalos are arrested after the body of 21-year-old Michael Goucher is found in the woods, stabbed more than 20 times.
Why would you bring a knife and a cleaver to a meeting?
September 2009, a 21-year-old Tony LoCascio is left to die after being beaten with baseball bats. He called himself a Juggalo, but it's alleged he snitched and lost his life.
The coroner said he was beaten 70 to 80 times with baseball bats.
We've got multiple individuals committing gang-related crimes, gang-motivated crimes, and they're using the name Juggalo.
Music that celebrates murder, suicide, and decapitation.
Our stuff is so unique because it's not on the radio, it's not on video channels and all that, that it's like this. Man, I want you to hear something. Check this out. You ain't never heard no like this.
How do you write a line like, from Pluto to your anus, we are underground fans?
For doom, it ain't a way face boobs in your face. That's dope, man. Welcome to the world of rap.
But isn't this almost pre-pubescent, barely literate?
Probably to you. You know
not
what I mean?
To me, I'm asking you.
Because you sound smart as a motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? It's not your cup of tea. Of course it probably sounds ridiculous to you. You know what I mean?
All marked with a man brandishing a hatchet. And then there are the concerts.
We bring 3 semis, 3 buses. We bring everything we can. Because we're about show business. We're about, you know, theatrics.
See the ringmaster taking position.
These are carefully choreographed events. All performed in front of dedicated fans, the Juggalos.
You figure a kid working all week at Taco Bell, you know what I'm saying? And he's gonna buy a ticket for $25, $30, whatever it costs, you know? You don't wanna see just some people up there just sitting on a stool playing a guitar. You know, you wanna see his entertainment.
A fixation with rape, violence, and murder in the lyrics particularly. What does it mean if you call a song, I'ma Kill You?
It means I'ma kill you. But I mean, how you take that? I mean, are you like a grown retard or something?
Yeah,
are you
gonna
go out and do it kind of murder to begin with? Then it might affect you really weird. But if you're anybody else, if you're normal, I can take you to Walmart and show you some pretty scary sounding horror movies.
We have to decide when we're talking to these guys. Who do we need to worry about and who don't we need to worry about?
Michelle Vasey came across Juggalos as a detective in Arizona. She now advises law enforcement across the country. After a series of murders and other violent acts linked to their followers, Juggalos are now classified as a gang in Utah, Arizona, and Monroe County in Pennsylvania.
The weapons, they prefer obviously hatchets, because they talk about that all the time. We got battle axes, we got machetes, we got anything that can make the most violent, gruesome wound. I don't want people to go out there and look at every Juggalo and go, oh my God, he's a gang member, he's got a machete on him and he's gonna slice and dice everybody. But people need to be aware that there's some huge issues going on that have evolved just within the last 3 years.
Case in point is the murder of Michael Goucher, who was found dead in the woods in Pennsylvania. One of the accused, Sean Freemore, was wearing an ICP t-shirt when he was arrested. And police say that Freemore wrote a rap about the alleged killing. Sitting here quietly thinking about my sin, he wrote, over and over about the knife going in.
Some of the homicides and stuff that we're seeing with these guys are pretty nasty, gruesome, disgusting homicides.
And the crimes are mounting. This is horrorcore rapper Sam McCroskey, aka Psycho Sam. Last October, he was charged with the brutal murders of his girlfriend and three others in Farmville, Virginia.
Here's the problem though, Violent J. A number of people who have been associated with serious criminal acts, acts of violence and murder, have had some kind of connection to ICP and Juggalos.
And I'm sure they watch Stephen King movies as well.
They're no longer regarded as innocent lovers of your music because of a number of horrendous crimes that have occurred.
I say bullshit. I say it's not true. I say
Let me give you an example. In February 2006, individual attacks people with a machete in a gay bar, kills a police officer in a traffic stop, and calls himself a juggler.
There's something wrong with that kid.
Jesus.
It ain't even beginning. You better holler at his parents and see how they raise
him. What about in September 2009? Sam McCroskey.
Come on, man. Who else do they listen to? Why don't you blame him?
What about February 2009? Michael Goucher stabbed 20 times by two self-proclaimed juggalos.
Well, you know, just the way you read these off is like, it's like a brutal attack to try to make it sound like our fans are these dangerous people when it's misconstrued thing.
Violent J, I didn't say that. I'm just reporting the facts of these cases. The individuals who perpetrated these murders and acts of violence were self-proclaimed juggalos.
I don't believe in this evidence you speak of. I don't believe that the juggalos are... I believe, yeah, out of the millions and millions that have bought of our albums, yes, some of them probably have committed horrendous crimes, but I don't believe...
You admit that?
Yeah, absolutely.
There remains no definitive evidence that watching a horror movie, playing a violent video game, or listening to the Insane Clown Posse actually causes people to commit crime.
You see how it's a very fine line for some of these kids. If they hear about killing someone, or raping somebody, or hurting somebody, then it's not a very big step for them to maybe think, hey, I wear the same clothes, I sing the same lyrics, maybe I'll do the same thing.
Like I was saying, there's a bad apple in every bunch, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, if that kid's got a screw loose, you know what I'm saying, it might take something else, not us, to set him off.
But others, like Michelle Vasey, argue that ICP, knowing the devotion of their Juggalo fans, should take more responsibility for their violent lyrics.
If they could use what they have, they could change and influence so many of these young kids' lives.
And though they sing about homicide and hatchets, this band of rappers wanted to make their position absolutely clear.
We ain't encouraging nobody.
We're not encouraging
anybody. We ain't saying go out and do this.
We ain't saying, hey, you go do this.
Telling the world we have face paint on. We are entertainers. If any of our fans kill somebody, please don't buy any more of our records. Get out of our lives, you're a sicko.
Nobody's ever seen a demon, so whatever the depiction of a demon is to them, what maybe they've seen on The Exorcist, maybe, or, you know what I'm saying, or something they've seen on a hot sauce bottle, you never know, you know what I'm saying, because nobody's ever seen a demon. We've seen evil throughout our whole lives, and our parents and their parents and grandparents, we've seen evil, but nobody's ever seen a demon. So when somebody says, my red crown that I had on my head looks like Satan, It's just what they think Satan might look like. You know what I'm saying? Or maybe it's the chin hair that they put on the hot sauce bottle. You know what I'm saying? That makes them think that, you know, because...
Grew up in the church, baby. You know what I mean? It's just my imagery is a lot more extreme than the regular.
Right.
And Jim Morrison. Oh, we do a lot of crazy things when we're on drugs. I've done some crazy stuff when I'm on drugs. I mean, when I was on drugs.
That's what I'm talking about. That's the new 2016, man. The modern Chris Calico.
Yes, sir.
Go Radio Tech 9 is here. My strange music brothers are in the building.
Yes, sir.
Tonight, man.
Yeah, man.
Myth, man.
We ready, man. We ready. We about to give them something even more different because they thought they'd seen everything, but now they're new additions, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
To the music and to the appearance.
Yeah, man.
You know what I mean?
No, you stop wearing the makeup.
No, I don't wear makeup. I wear face paint.
Rewind. No.
You gotta, no, keep that.
I don't want to disrespect
you. No, keep that.
You got to
everybody
on war paint.
Keep that.
Because everybody says
everybody does it to me.
I did Karen 11 last week. They put some makeup on me. Okay?
Yeah,
different when you were doing
it. Nah, even my security saying, you got your makeup? I'm like, no. I got my face paint. You know what I'm saying? So keep it, man.
But you're not doing it.
But a mother named Carol.
In 1989, DJ Paul and Lord Infamous formed the duo Serial Killers. 2 years later, 3-6 Mafia would get formed. That's probably the group you're familiar with. The group is well known for earning an Academy Award. The most horrorcore members of the group are DJ Paul, Gangsta Boo, and definitely Lord Infamous. Lord Infamous was the darkest member by far. His flow was so devilish and his lyrics were demented. Songs like Scarecrow Melody and Is Anyone Out There are horrorcore classics. His lyrics touched on subjects such as Satanism, mass murder, and torture. On December 20th, 2013, Lord Infamous died of a heart attack. He died in his sleep at his mother's home in Memphis. DJ Paul would take his casket on tour after his passing. It's unknown if his body was actually inside. In 1997, Eminem dropped a Slim Shady EP. Featuring constant references to drug use, sexual acts, mental instability, and over-the-top violence. He also explored more serious themes, like dealing with that of poverty, and his response to criticism, and of course his marriage and family difficulties. But everybody knows about Eminem. I do consider him horrorcore at times, especially during the relapse era, but the most horrorcore artist I heard on the Slim Shady EP was D12 bandmate Bizarre. His solo music is on another level of disturbing. He raps about doing unspeakable things to children. When he's in his evil mind state, there's no telling what he'll say. Despite the often over-the-top content, Bizarre can flow, and he's very underrated.
Today my wife left. I don't give a fuck. Bitch, that's why I'm paying you $150.
How much for me and my man?
To suck. Me and Conniver. Let this diabetic dick touch your saliva. I take him blind and crazy. Being a 48, ever since we fuck, I've been coughing and losing weight. Staying home, trying to creep. Bitch, pick your son up, he been at school for a week. You fucking freak, trying to get the best of me. Kidnap your ass, leave you lost like Kelly without destiny. You stink trick, you suck dick. Jason Williams,
what up?
Shoot this dirty bitch.
Crazy Bone, aka Leatherface, the sawed off gangster. Suck it. AKA the number one assassin. Third, Busy Bone. AKA Rest in Peace. Fourth, Wishbone. AKA Straight Jacket Nigga.
Formed in Cleveland, Ohio in 1991, the group was originally called the Band-Aid Boys. They were then formed into Bone Enterprise, eventually becoming what we know today as Bone Thugs and Harmony. Before the group met Eazy-E and signed to Ruthless Records, they would link with a local record company, and they dropped their album Faces of Death, their debut project. I would definitely categorize this as a horrorcore album. The cover art, though poor quality, was extremely sinister, and songs like Hellscent and Sons of Assassin were extremely evil. But Bone's evil was just getting started. Creeping on a Come Up was their debut EP, released on June 21st, 1994. The second track on the album was a short skit called Mr. Ouija.
I was home one day, Lil Lay,
And one of my dudes named Wally come over to the house, you know, and they was like, yo, we gotta show you something. And I'm like, what? They're like, you gonna trip off this. And I'm like, what? You know, what is it? So we went over to Lay Mama house, you know what I'm saying? And we went to his bedroom and they closed the door and he was like, look what we got. And they put out a Ouija board. Now, I had never seen a Ouija board ever. I didn't even know what it was. And they said somebody had given it to them and showed them how to play it. So I thought nothing of it, you know what I'm saying? We all sat down on the bed and it was like, you gotta be serious when we play this. Okay. They said, they said, you can't be joking around, you gotta be serious. So they were playing and I'm sitting back watching and they start saying, Ouija, are you with me? You know, and that's where we got the idea for the song, you know, of course. But they start saying, Ouija, are you with me? And I'm looking around the room saying to myself, who the hell are they talking to?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Then I started thinking it was a joke, and I'm thinking somebody gonna bust out the closet on me or something. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, okay. You know, because we always pranked each other like that. You know what I'm saying? So they started asking all these questions and the thing started moving. But honestly, to this day, no lie. I actually think it was laying my dude moving it. Like, no lie. They tried to put a fast one on me.
You think it didn't work?
They tried to put it on, because when I tried it, it never moved for me.
Right.
It never moved for me. I don't know if it's because it was a Parker Brothers one and we didn't take it down to the bayou to get the voodoo put on it. To get the voodoo put on it or what it was, you know what I'm saying? But it never worked for me. So then we played it a second time at my mama house and we asked it a bunch of questions about us making it and all that. Again, they played it and I watched it because I was having a hard time believing that it was actually moving by itself. I'm like, bro, I don't believe it.
All right.
And then that same night, my mother came upstairs in my room and caught us playing it, bro. She flipped her wig, bro. My mama never used to cuss, never used to curse, bro. Never used curse words. She sounded like a drunken sailor that night. She was like,
that day.
Y'all get your asses the fuck out of here right now, bro. Like, no lie, bro. She was like letting us have it, like, kicked me out the house, and I was only 16. And she's like, I'm like, hey, mom, I'm still a minor, you know?
Right.
She's like, I don't care. You bring that shit in my house, you can leave with it. Yeah. That's how serious it was.
What would really solidify the group and their evil nature was their 1995 release, E Eternal 1999. This project was filled with evil. They even blessed us with a sequel to Mr. Ouija, along with many other horrorcore anthems, such as Me Killa, Die Die Die, Land of the Heartless, Down 71, and of course Mo Murda. Mo Murda is arguably the darkest horrorcore track ever made. In 2002, a convicted murderer named Michael Tysis played the song in front of a Missouri Supreme Court. He claimed listening to the song repeatedly for 45 minutes led to him killing two Randolph County correctional officers. E Eternal is evil down to the artwork. The front cover is the group standing in a hell version of their old neighborhood. In one of the buildings, you can even see Eazy-E looming in the window. This was super creepy because he had just passed away 4 months prior to its release. When you open the CD, the CD case, and remove the disc, there is a backwards prayer to the devil. Bone would continue to make sinister music throughout their career up to this day. Each member bringing their own demented alias. Busy Bone, Lil Ripsta, Lazy Bone, Number One Assassin, Flesh and Bone, Fifth Dog, Wish and Bone, Straight Jacket, and Crazy Bone was Leatherface. While the entire group has made some very dark songs, only one has been accused of actual devil worshiping and potentially being possessed. It's alleged that Busy Bone was actually possessed when he went on a spiritual rant during an interview with a Houston radio station. The interview's about 12 minutes long, so I chopped it down in about half to the best parts.
Sure, it's only one true God representative, and you thought it was my test. Holla, 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 holla!
Special guest in the studio, man. Extremely special.
Love,
what's
love,
up, man?
love, cross the be out. It's only one true God. You know how we do it, man. What's the dealio? How things going down here in the H-Town, man? I've been down here, man, just relaxing and vaxing, man. I ain't seen nobody bring me no money yet.
I haven't seen anybody bringing any money in H-Town.
Well, you already know how it is. When we look at money, we don't look at that paper. Render unto Caesar's what Caesar, render to God was God.
Yeah?
Yeah, most definitely. It's a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual movement. Most of my people at the mall, they know what's going on. Most of my people over there at the Scottish Inns, they know what's going on. Most of my people over there at the hotel over there by my family, you already know what's going on. You know how we rolling. Ain't no time to be playing. That's what's up. One true God and representative. Please believe it. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. How you doing?
Man, what brings you down here, bro?
Well, you know, man, I've just been moving and you know what I'm saying? And ain't got nowhere to live, really. You understand what I mean? So, you know, we looking for somewhere to live. We looking for something to eat. When I was sleeping at the bus station, everybody was laughing at me. You know what I'm saying? I had calluses up under my feet. Everybody was laughing at me, but I'm up in this motherfucker. Oh, my goodness, did I come? Excuse me.
Yeah, the station manager's here. Great.
My bad. Tell the station manager that I love him. Oh, my goodness, there go the phone.
Man.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. I ain't even going to take it no further. Pardon me. Pardon me.
No, that's all right, man.
Okay.
Now, from the sounds of things, sounds like you're not just homeless. Maybe you're a nomad.
Well, you know, some people was, you know what I'm saying, and that's a good word, nomad. I ain't mad. You know what I mean? We just handling it, and we doing what we need to do, man, and we living, and we praising God every step of the way, and some people may say that gospel thing and what they really want to see, and some people may say that they ain't really what they trying to be on, but trust and believe, and when you talking about the Creator, you ain't talking about that, you know what I mean? You talking about some realness, you understand what I mean? And that's, ooh, it's so real.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God.
Yeah?
Yes.
You're going in the way of the gospel.
Oh, well, you are somebody on some, like, some evil levels. You know, the evil level, you know what I'm saying, is lavish. They, you know what I mean, they Bentley drivers. You understand what I'm saying? If you, you know what I mean, you on that level and you of this world and you on that, you know what I'm saying, and the slobber going down your cheeks and, you know what I'm saying, and the nectar going down your neck. And you know what I mean? That's got a lot to do with that bread. But when you roll it around here, when you feeding your people down there on the streets, you understand what I'm saying? With the nectar. That's what I'm talking about. Holla back.
The nectar. Yeah. Well, man,
yeah.
Now, tell me, when I was growing up there, I saw Bone on TV all the time. I saw y'all blowing up, man.
As well. Well, you know, when you look at blowing up and you look at the different things, once you get to the physical realm of it, and once you start looking at it like that, that's why you stay in the streets. That's why you stay in the hood. That's why you stay around the people that ain't got nothing, because they ain't got nothing to say but love.
Yeah.
We can pray for the best. You understand what I'm saying? Ain't gonna be no waltzing in. Holla.
Right, now that's where it's at. Though,
yes, sir.
Too. Man, you can stay here a while, or what's the next?
Oh, man, bootleg it or something. I ain't trying to hear none of that, man. Keep it real. It don't even come near me. Don't come around me. Don't buy nothing. It don't matter to me. That's how I get down. It's real. When I see you, you already know how I feel about you, and I'm gonna see you regardless.
See who?
Everybody we're talking to.
Everybody, man.
Yeah, because, you know, we're not just talking to each other. We're talking
right.
to a lot of people around the radius.
Yeah. A lot of people listening on the internet at kpft.org. What's up, y'all?
All right. One love. One is that hard.
Hey, can I ask you a question?
Test that mind. Test that soul. Test that heart. Test that mind.
Hey,
Can you do a freestyle
for us one time?
Well, you know, I mean, just a freestyle, you know what I'm saying? It's only one true God. It's only one true God. And see, as I walk through the valley of the shadow with death, with flesh and blood, I let evil question us. And you know how we bust, we lay back in the cut. I see the sinister mind, and you blinded. Look at him, and he find it when I nibbled that tree of science. You thought you was laughing at Brian. Holler back, that's enough.
Man.
Crazy Bone is a lyrical mastermind. Everybody knows that. When he raps his best, he can paint a crime scene with his lyrics. In 1999, he would really begin to dabble in the horrorcore genre. On his debut project, Thug Mentality, he featured a new group that he started, called the Night Riders, a group from Cleveland, Ohio, consisting of four MCs, Silence, who was Crazy Bone, Psycho Bitch, who was Laricia, Deadly Whispers, who was Sin of the Graveyard Shift, and The Widowmaker, who was Mohart of Poetic Hustlers. The group's appearance was extremely unique. Their image was described as evil pirates. They wore full black gowns with capes, masks, and makeup. Musically, Crazy described the group of sounding a mix between rock and rap, but I don't think that's very accurate. It sounds more like the music Satan would play at one of his parties, a lot of it being oddly catchy. The members relied heavily on voice effects, and most of their songs were heavy samples of 1970s rock and roll. The group would be featured on many Crazy Bone projects, but their debut album was ultimately shelved. The album is called The Underland and is available on YouTube.
So 10, man, you about to fall asleep and I'm out your window with a mask on. I proceed to climb through the data room with a machete that I'm about to shove into your backbone. To cut it down into your asshole, I bloody up your fucking bathrobe. And if your wife is awake and she witnessing when I'm doing a killer, then I fill a pussy up with tadpoles. Yes, I'm that gross.
I didn't know about horrorcore music and all that. You know, I just made music that was just, it was just what I did. And so a lot of juggalos and horrorcore fan bases start jumping on me. So they were the first ones. And you know, they're, and then it was strange to me because I was like, I don't know what the fuck these people are. Like, this shit is like, I've never seen nobody, like, these motherfuckers are crazy. I ain't never seen nothing like this in my life. It's been so weird to just be introduced to this subculture. Like, yeah. And then they're all like, and then they're talking to me because they, I guess the way I rapped, it reminded them of other, you know, Juggalo rappers are
Twisted, shout out to them.
Yeah, and they're all dope, you know, they're all the homies. So, and I've gotten to know them over the years, you know, but at the time I was just like, this is a foreign world. I don't know what this is. I don't know who these people are. And as I got into it, you know, they're very supportive. They show crazy love, you know. And yeah. And when I did my first tour, it was all, you know, horrorcore fan base, Juggalos. And you know, it was a little shocking at first. I'm like, man, like, everybody has their face painted, and I didn't get it. I didn't get it, and I'm like, what is going on here? Because no one where I live does this right at all. Like, I don't even know one.
Must have been so
What up, y'all? My name is Monoxide.
My name is Jamie Madrock.
We're Twisted. We're from the east side of Detroit.
The killers and crazy folks, the painted people, and yeah. 3-6 is fucking with them. It was like props to 3-6. You know, they'll always have a special little
right.
ventricle in our heart. For real, man.
DJ
that
Paul, Juicy J.
Yes, sir.
Gangsta Boo. I'm going to kiss your lips one day.
You got to stop harassing Boo, man, for real. I've already got restraining orders and shit. It's just, it's got to
be. Sorry.
The first bone yeah. EP?
Yeah. That was a full length. Hardcore. Faces of Death, it was a full length for Bone Thugs and Harmony, and they were on some wicked shit. It was
next
dope.
Thing you know, it's like, gotta feel strong. Gotta feel bone. Like, they was feeling it.
The biggest MC in the world is a wicked rapper.
Right.
He kicks the wicked shit. You right. know what I mean? It's just, he was created through the mainstream. Mm-hmm. We were not.
Right.
So what the mainstream does not create, it does not understand. And either they take a chance and they come and see what it's about, or they just shun it. Like, we want nothing to do with it. I believe everything that they've said about them is true, so good enough for me.
And also from our plateau, it's like, our standpoint rather, it's like, you know, we're a little more intimidating looking, where he was a lot more packageable. You know what I mean?
He was with a chainsaw and a Jason mask.
He was, but then, you know, you seen him, and he was just like, he was like regular folk. You know what I mean? It's like, you see me and you, we do not equate to regular folk. We walk down the street, motherfuckers eyeballing us like, I seen the devil.
Not here, though. L.A., they don't give a fuck.
You know, L.A., yeah.
I love it. I love it.
Right in L.A.
Right.
It was darker. I wanted to do a chopping type of style that was kind of darker, that because there was a lot of poppy shit on the radio back in the day. It was a lot of cross colors, and people, everybody around California was wearing cross colors, all type of shit back then. You know, what was that one, that shit was a little poppy radio song, but it was all type of different stuff coming on, and I wanted to be a little darker edge.
Yeah. Yeah, I was gonna ask you, man. Like, where does that dark come from? Like, who were some of the guys that you were listening to that like made you want to rap in that genre? You know what I mean? Like,
well, shit, I was listening to shit wasn't even rap. I was listening to Alice Cooper and Black Sabbath and weird shit. You know what I mean?
Oh,
it was
wow.
a kind of a darker thing. I was always into, you know, watching horror movies and shit. You know, but believe it or not, I was influenced by a video I seen, Michael Jackson's Thriller, and it was like a bigger scale, kind of dark-ass vibe. I never forget how I felt when I was a kid. I was be scared of that video. But,
yeah.
You know, and I don't know. That was, you know, something that it put a different feeling in me, and I wanted to put that type of feeling in my music.
That's crazy, man. Like Gangster Nip came along. You know, the South Park
style. Yeah, Gangsta Dip type. Fuck.
Yeah.
You know, I remember when I first heard Gangsta Dip, I was like, what the fuck is this? You know, I was a tech.
Yeah, Nip was crazy with this. You know, I'm an aerodynamic, satanic, schizophrenic android.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
At that time,
I never heard nothing like that. I was like, holy shit.
Horrorcore has come a long way since its inception. There are a lot of talented MCs that have contributed to the genre, such as King Gordy, Aquelio, Flatbush Zombie, Suicide Boys, C-Mob, Grave Diggas, Blaze Your Dead Homie, Cottonmouth Kings, King Iso, the list goes on. One thing each of these MCs have in common is their incredible ability to storytell in their rap and paint a picture, almost like a scary movie in their lyrics.
Kill myself with the same gun Martin Luther died with. On the same street Kennedy caught them live hits. Need to ask God now about the sins I did. This damn Bible's making my third eye twitch. Is this heaven? Ain't seen many wide halls in the lobby while three friendly guys talk about murders. A grim many died, all Jeffrey's head. I think Lee Harry Oswald. Can't